Okay, hi everyone. I'm Darin Lobo, and this is the prosthetic arm project. So, from here, from these statistics, you can see that there's clearly a demand for prosthetic arms. But the thing is, the cost. But the cost of prosthetic limbs is pretty much absurd. Can anyone here guess what is the rough range of prices for prosthetic arm? Any guesses? Okay, who thinks it's in the hundreds range? Thousand? 10,000? 10,000? 20,000? 30? 40? All the way to 100,000? Well, this is the actual cost. So roughly for a mere electric prosthetic arm, it can go around $30,000 to $100,000. Especially for a functional one. And DARPA has recently developed a mind control prosthetic arm that costs about $100,000, but was developed at $100 million. So that's clearly too much for a normal person to afford. And usually the people who are affected most are people who do labor or non-skilled jobs that require them to be able to use their arms and legs. So first, I'm just going to go through some introductory biology on how the arm, so I can explain how the arm works. So basically, when you think of something or you want to do something, your brain uses electrical messages to communicate with your body, right? So the question is, how can we intercept these signals, how can we detect them, and how can we interpret them? So if you can see here, this is a synapse. So basically, neurotransmitters go across the synapse in order to carry information. So I'll explain why this is important later. I'll just carry on first. So the first method of viewing these electrical signals is electroencephalography. So basically, we are trying to understand the brain waves by measuring the electrical signals, and using a Fourier transform, we are converting them to a sinusoidal input. So with that, we can understand how the brain works and how information is carried. So we are using a machine learning software to basically understand its signals and use it to control servos or soft robotic arm or whatever we need. So let's say I want to do this. Basically, my brain will send a certain signal, and if I can measure the signals in the motor cortex using EEG, I can sort of understand what the brain is trying to send. The second one, which is much more accurate, is electromyography, which is basically measuring electrical inputs, electrical signals in the muscles. So this is currently one of the methods I'm using, and this is actually the device that I'm using. It's called a Mio band, which is also used by DARPA. So basically, I use the electroencephalogram and electromyogram, which interfaces with an Arduino microcontroller. And basically that sends serial information on basically the electrical signals, which is processed by the Mio software, which was not made by me. And coupled with the machine learning software, it basically analyzes the signal and tries to figure out what you're trying to do. And with that, I'm using two types of prosthetic arms. One is a soft robotic arm, and one is a mechanical arm. So using that, I use it to control the arms. So most prosthetic arms don't have sensory feedback. So you don't know how much pressure you're using to hold an object. The arm doesn't know whether you're holding an egg or a glass or a metal weight. So it doesn't know how much force to use. Also, if you bang your arm on the wall or you damage it in some sort of way, you have no idea what's going on. And it also doesn't feel natural. And you can also, a lot of people with amputees, they experience something called phantom limb pain, which is basically, since there's no input, the body feels that there's something wrong because there's no information going where the arm used to be. So we can solve this by stimulating the brain. So then, multiple methods of doing this. I go for the traditional non-invasive method. So over here, this is the somatosensory cortex, which is basically the part that controls motor function and allows you to feel. So I'm trying to stimulate the somewhere around 3A to 3B in order to evoke a tactile sensation in your fingers. So there are multiple ways. So now I'm going to get back to the synapse. So basically how electrical signals travel across the synapse is when there's enough action potential, neurotransmitters go across the membrane to complete the gap and thus send an electrical signal. However, with ultrasonic neuromodulation, you're basically vibrating the cells at a particular frequency that increases the permeability, allowing more neurotransmitters to go across. Therefore, you can artificially elicit sensation by stimulating the synapses using ultrasonic neuromodulation. Another thing is transcranial magnetic stimulation. So because in your neurons, you have ion channels and you have ions that flow throughout the cell, which allows you to have action potentials and allows electrical signals to be invoked. So using transcranial magnetic stimulation, we're actually inducing a current within the neuron to elicit sensation. Now, there are two other methods. These are quite simple. Anyone can try this at home. One is ultrasonic nerve stimulation, and the other is direct electrical stimulation. So ultrasonic stimulation works the same way as transcranial ultrasonic stimulation. It's basically you vibrate the synapses in your nerves, therefore allowing an action potential to occur. So you actually feel a sensation. The same thing for electrical nerve stimulation. This you're directly inducing current within the cells. So now I'm going to talk about the difference between a soft robotic versus a mechanical arm. So when you think of soft robotics, you can think more of actuators and pneumatic cylinders, things like that, which use air and fluids in order to create motion, something like how a squid moves, versus a traditional mechanical arm, which uses servos, wires, like motors, things like that. So soft robotics can actually store energy. Like because they're soft and maneuverable, they can bend, they have a much wider range of motion with the same cost range. So but some problems are soft robotics are hard to model. So basically how you want it to move and all is quite difficult. But they are much cheaper because servos and things like that are really expensive. Especially with an arm, you need multiple degrees of motion, and there are multiple fingers and ways that you can move each finger. I mean, if you just try yourself, you can probably move your finger all around, you know. So if I were to do that with servos, it would be much more expensive, because I would need at least 5-6 servos per finger. So did it work? Well, sort of. So here you can see on top, I made a soft robotic glove. So basically this, I have fluids that go into the reservoir, which allows me to maneuver the arm. And on the bottom is the mechanical arm. So you can see the Raspberry Pi and Arduino within the inner part of it that controls the arm. So the second one has servo motors and all. That is just a prototype. So over here, this is the signal generator and amplifier that I'm using. That's the amplifier that I'm using to do the ultrasonic stimulation. Because for the transducers, you need a really high voltage. And this is actually a part of a Neurosky EEG headset that I modified in order to use for my experiments. And this was the first prototype. So you can see how the arm works, this mechanical arm. So basically the servo motor here pulls the strings, which allows you to move the arm. And because the strings acts like a spring, it stores energy, the fingers snap back once you stop. So there are multiple different applications of the technology that I mentioned. So basically, if you could stimulate the brain, there's lots of possibilities that you can do. You can cure depression, you can help people with problems who can't, who have for example, people who have cerebral atrophy and they can't really control their body because their brains are sending wrong signals. So you can intercept these signals and you can generate your own. So what's the future of the project? Well, since it's all open source, I'm releasing everything online on GitHub and other platforms, so anyone can continue the project and try it out at home for themselves. Or there are lots of non-profits like Engineering Good that I'll be talking to see if they want to try to implement it. Because right now we are quite close, we can actually create a prototype that someone could use. And especially for the price range. So the arm here currently costs about $500 if you could buy everything brand new. But because I got all the parts second hand and some of the parts I wired together myself, I managed to get it for about $100. $100 to $200, which is really affordable. So you can follow the project here on GitHub. This is my email if you're interested in contacting me to find out more about the project. You can also see, I'm going to post some pictures on Instagram also, so you can have a look there. Are there any questions? Yeah.
So, main components or what are the materials that we need in order to replicate one before we can?
You mean replicate a simplified model or
something that we can?
You can do at home.
Yeah.
Okay, so
what we need to get, like, what
do we need to buy? Okay, so if you're just doing it at home and you're not really making a prototype, you can use things that you have at home, like you can use your laptop instead of a Raspberry Pi for an interface. And you can you just need an Arduino. Like, I can show you the... This was the original project at Science Hack Day. So this is... we were just trying to get whatever things we had at home and try to build it in one day. So this is actually some guitar strings, popsicle sticks, a few nuts and bolts, and it's just mounted on a normal plywood board. And I'm just using Arduino at the moment and one servo motor. And that's enough to give you normal contraction. Now, you also need a EG device or EMG. So if you can use the Mio band, which you can probably purchase for about $50 second hand, or you can try to build your own, but that's a bit difficult if you're doing at home. It's the Mio band, MYO, if you're interested in having a look. You can also use it to control your computer or do other things with it. So, did that answer your question?
Yeah, mostly, I guess.
Okay.
I mean, how many servos do you use for
that? For the current prototype, I have 12 servos.
12 servos?
Yeah.
So you need a servo shield controller?
Yeah, I'm using a motor controller. But,
you build your own shield controller?
Yeah.
Okay.
How do you attach it to
the
person?
That is, you can do that. So there are different ways. So sometimes they utilize like a socket. So you just put the stump of your arm into the socket and you can strap it on. But there are some more advanced ones like the DARPA project, which I have a picture right here, where you can see it. Right. Okay, it's, hold on one moment. It's gone for some reason. Yeah, so you can see the arm is actually physically joined to his bone. So it's like an extension of his actual arm. So that really depends, but also matters on your price range. Because this arm here costs about $100,000. Any other questions?
So is this can it be used for legs?
Yeah, why not? It's just the part that you need to view is just a different area of the cortex.
I mean, the person, like, the newcomer wants to try it out, but they need a deep study of how brain works and get the right points to...
Yeah, exactly. Normally, you'd use the MRI and all to find the correct area. And it also depends on your budget. Because EEG is accurate, but the most accurate would be ECOG, which is implanted, where they put electrodes directly on the brain. But that is expensive, and I can't do that at home, so... Also, for a leg, you won't really need such precision. You could just have a a motor controller with a leg that basically moves when the other move leg moves. So basically, when you move your torso, the leg just follows. You don't need to actually interpret signals from the brain for that. But because the arm is very complex and you have multiple kinds of movements that you can do, you need that.
That means the leg prototype
I guess in that sense, yeah. But it's also doing the fittings and everything. Also, the leg is much bigger, so it's difficult in that sense, mechanical sense, but not really in interpreting signals. So you won't really need to tap into the brain.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else? Yeah. Okay, so you see, basically when he wants to move his arm, his body sends signals through the motor nerves that goes through the arm, right? And over here you can see these two sensors. So basically each one is an 8-channel EMG device, so that measures the electrical signals in the arm. And basically that tells the robotic arm what to do. Anything else?
In terms of feedback, like when the robotic arms brush against a table or something, will we feel anything? Is there anything communicated back?
Yeah, that's what I meant by the sensory feedback. So when you touch something, you will actually feel it, even though it's a robotic arm, because the signals are sent back into the brain, because you're stimulating the somatosensory cortex.
Is it through the myo?
Not through the myoband, but through the give me a moment. Through the magnetic stimulation, transcranial magnetic stimulation, where you induce a current within the brain. Because all your signals in your brain move through neurons, right? If you were to create a signal within the brain, an artificial signal, it would perceive it as feeling. And because of the shape of the coil, you can actually focus the magnetic field in a very close area. So basically you can stimulate each individual feeling.
Does that coil have to be put somewhere on the body, the patch?
So it can either be held above, but that's really impractical. Most likely it will be implanted, or you could have a really flat version that you could stick on the scalp.
How much degree of rotation can have?
For my arm or for? So mine only has 1 degree of rotation, which is in the wrist. Because otherwise there's, you need too many servos and too many things. But the soft robotic arm has much more degrees of motion. Basically, for my arm, it's I'm assuming the person is amputated at the forearm, so I didn't build this part on.
Is that the
how accurate can the simulation be? For example, can the simulation differentiate holding an egg versus holding a stone?
You can. And that's also the reason for the sensory feedback, right? Because if you were to hold a stone, you could feel the texture versus an egg, right? And also you know how much pressure to put. If I can't feel anything, I don't know how hard I'm gripping something. But if I can feel it, I know exactly how much force I'm using. So with the sensory feedback, basically when the arm grabs something, you can use touch sensors that can feel the amount of force that communicates it back to the brain. Yeah.
So is there a possibility that we get the wrong signal to brain and cause some, like, it feels like nothing happened, but person may feel like it's a lot of pain.
Okay, so you mean if you stimulate the wrong area?
Yeah.
Yeah. That could cause a lot of problems if you stimulate the wrong area. Because, for example, EMS is also used to treat depression. Basically, if you can stimulate the brain, right, the brain is extremely complex. If you don't focus it correctly, you can cause a lot of damage. One being seizures. If you create a closed loop sensation, you can create seizures. So basically, you have to be careful in that sense. And you don't build this yourself and just try it at home. So this a professional will align it and everything and ensure that it's working properly.
Okay, thank you.